Welcome, welcome. I'm not going to use the microphone. Clearly, I'm loud enough without it. So I'm going to get us started here with a little spoken word myself. Yes. We are running after humanity as it disappears. Feel, hear, smell, touch, see it as it dissolves. No one is absolved of their responsibility to save it, reclaim it, honor it, and name it. It starts here in this space, where we disrupt fear, suspend pain, energize the atmosphere with good intentions and claims. So, lift every voice, strum every chord, beat every drum, and keep moving towards understanding, activism, justice, and love. Hate, discord, and vitriol are the symptoms. The cure can be found within creative ecosystems. So welcome. Welcome to our ecosystem of creatives. Let this be a space for you to restore, replenish, and top off your soul. My name is Alinda Canty. I'm the Vice President of the Hopkinton Freedom Team. Tonight's music and poetry jam is the first in the Artful Connections series here at the HCA. Artful Connections is a collaboration between the Hopkinton Freedom Team and the Hopkinton Center for the Arts, which will involve bringing you artful events with a social justice theme. In honor of Earth Day, tonight's theme is A Call for a Just World through Poetry and Music. First, I would like to give a shout out to John B. Puri, whose love of connecting through poetry and music sparked this event. She also led and organized all of it. As well, a huge shout out to the Freedom Team members and the team here at the HCA whose efforts also made tonight possible. Before we begin, we ask that you share this space with respect, generosity, love, inclusion, and trust. Let's help make it as safe a space as possible as our artists enrich us with their gifts. We also ask that you take care of yourselves and care for this community. Bathrooms are downstairs, snacks are on the table. So, without further ado, our spotlight poet tonight is the one and only Jamel Adams. Jamel has a list of accomplishments, and there are a plethora of adjectives I could use to describe him. But I think the one word that encapsulates him best is love. Jamel is all about love. So let's give him a warm welcome as he works his way.
Intro, show some more love. All right, so I'm gonna get a little more comfortable. Not that the teddy bears aren't comfy, I like the teddy bears. But if you could, take out your cell phones, if you have your cell phones, take it out. If you don't, sit next to someone who does have one. There's a reason for this. There's a whole reason. So, the call can't happen without your voice. So I need you to remember your voices. Say my voice.
My voice.
Oh, this is community. It's not just me, one of us speaking and you. Tonight, the energy that you emit is the energy you will get from all the artists and the musicians. Is that true? Yes?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
So let's be present. Okay. Say my voice.
My voice
is important.
It is important.
Turn to the person next to you on your left or your right. Say your voice is important.
Remember that.
Now, what I want you to do while you have your phones out, very quickly, go to the notes section of your phone. Go to the notes section of your phone. Go to the notes section of your phone. Right. And then what I would like you to do is write three lines of poetry, just three. just three lines of poetry, all right? And it's only gonna be 17 syllables altogether. Who knows what I'm talking about? What kind of poetry? A haiku, exactly. Haiku originates in what part of the world?
Japan.
And it's based on three lines of poetry on a 17 syllable count. The first line is how many syllables?
Five.
Second line is how many syllables?
Seven.
Last line is how many syllables?
Five.
Again, 5, 7, 5. Okay, if you don't know how to start, I've created the perfect beginning. Where do I begin? There you go. And you can be as creative as you want to with your haiku. You also can speak in any languages that you have within them. It does not need to be in English. I'll ask you one time. Does it have to be in English?
No.
All right, so you can use whatever languages are within your persona to create. What I want you to do is write a haiku in a minute based on the power of your voice. Go, the power of your voice. You got a minute. The power of your voice. Interesting. I just started doing it. It does. The power of your voice.
People spend lifetimes just writing one haiku.
Lifetimes just writing one haiku. That's 7 syllables. Right there. Lifetime writing one haiku.
Well, all right.
That's 7. All right. There you go. Now, in lieu of your voices and the haikus that you just wrote, take this into your energy. And do I need this for the recording? No, everything's all right. One of the most dangerous sounds on earth is every time you hear it, there's secrecy, danger, or the silencing of someone. Shh. Be quiet. Shh. Don't say a word. I can't ever recall hearing it and feeling relief. Like, shh. Women, you're about to be liberated right now. Or shh. Breathe. That gun's not pointed at you. It's pointed at that slavery behind you. Oh, shh. There is no box to check. We're all human. Shh. It can be so maddening. I remember hearing, shh, step out the car, put your hands up at that place for 100 to call. I remember hearing the teacher say, shh, Jamil, stop acting like that. But feeling, like she said, shh, Jamil, stop acting so black. Remember the first time you heard, shh? Remember the first time you said, shh? You ever shift a dead body? You ever knew so much people ask you, shh. Knowledge is so loud. Knowledge is so loud. They shh in the library. You ever shift the soul? You ever been silenced, interrupted, made not important, shh, made not to matter, shh, silently hung, shh. Remember your voice. Remember your voice. Your voices are important. Our voices are oftentimes our strongest muscles. Sometimes we use them without saying a word. Obedient. And don't allow yourself to ever be silenced. Again, take that and that energy and add one more line to that. Silence never means you have nothing to say. Sometimes silence speaks volumes. Take a deep breath in on three. 1, 2, 3. Let it out. 4, 5, 6. One more time. 1, 2, 3. Let it out. 4, 5, 6. That just looks so. Gotta breathe a little bit. Y'all all right? You good? You're good, yes?
Yes.
Let's see what y'all got. Who wants to share with their room? Who wants to share with their room? Let's go for it. Yes, go for it. You can do it the way you are. First time speaking out in front of people. Show love. Show love. Go for it. Go for it.
I am strength and love. My voice carries me proudly. Loud is not a sin. And then I added, my voice speaks for others as well as for myself. Oh,
yeah. Loud is not a sin. Locked in. That hit me so loud. Loud is not a sin. Who else? Who else? Who else is moved to share what they wrote? I've seen people writing. Anyone else? Uh-oh. Go ahead. Yes. Show more love. More love. More love. Yeah.
Voice is my paintbrush. The whole world is my canvas. Erase pain with love. I will not be silenced.
Anyone else? Anyone else? Anyone else? Yes. Show more love. Show some more love. Show some more love. Yes.
Our voice is strong. Our voice makes us happy. We need our voice. Our voices overcome.
Our voices overcome. Yes. Yes. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anyone else move to share? Yes. Go for it. Show love. Let's show some love. Go for it. Yes. But I knew it had to do with voice and empowerment. I knew it had to do with that. Yeah.
Yes. A strong voice, though the sky is high, keeps shouting.
Ooh. Although the sky. Woo! Fire! Anyone else? Anyone else? Anyone else? You said we didn't have open mic. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anyone else join the shit? Anyone else? Anyone? Anyone? All right, so this is what I want you to do right now. There's someone, find a partner real quick. Find a partner. Find a partner. Quick, like 10 seconds. Find a partner. Find a partner. I know we married, but you, someone can partner right there. Someone find a partner. 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 You can be groups of three, too, if you need to. You can be high numbers. Find a partner. All right? Now, this is what I want you to do. You got a minute. 2 minutes this time. You got 2 minutes, write a free verse poem. It doesn't have to be long, but what it's about, unified voices. Go, that's the top, unified voices. Go for it. Unified voices. I got about 2 minutes on that. Unified voices. I'm gonna look you up, unified voices. You gotta go for unified voices.
You got about
30 seconds. The camera person doesn't have a partner. Oh, we should have did one together. We should have did one together. That's cool too, but we would definitely like to have the pieces because they're in people's phones. You can text them to us. All right, so I wasn't going to do this tonight, but I'm going to do it in lieu of what happened in Ohio recently with Dyson and another black male that died while in custody with the police. And so let's just go 20 questions, and then we'll take a break after this. I think it's just like been 20 minutes. Then we're going to have people go. No, is that everyone? Yeah, right?
Yeah,
I mean, break for me. So, not like break. It was like, I'm gonna stop, and then other folks are gonna come. All right, that was weird. Yeah. Did y'all see how whole communication took place without words? It was like, oh, this is what's happening. Okay. For the next 3 minutes, I will represent the voice of every black man in history. Don't mind how impossible that sounds. I dare you to simply ask that which the only the wind will howl and blow. You got 20 seconds with me. Go. Do you think about being black every day? Like my life depended on it because it does. What is the most hurtful assumption that has been made about you? That God doesn't live inside me. What is your greatest fear? Not being recognized for the genius that I am. How come you run so fast? You would too if the whole world wanted to kill you. Why do you have so many children and baby mamas? Well, in the search for, that's really a silly question, but in the search of companionship, sometimes love happens and babies represent the love, not the bond. Understand, so for real though, if everyone could walk in your shoes for an hour, what do you think their greatest discovery would be? That I'm worthy of their prayers and love. What brings the biggest smile to your face? Family. Who do you cry to? I usually have a private moment in a place of a public solitude, like a movie theater, crying over some shit like why they won't accept Happy Feet for the way that he is. Otherwise, I'll always have to be strong. If you could be anything in the world, what would it be? A woman. Do you dream about dragons? That is another stupid question. What kind of questions? Now, of course I dream about questions. Hell yeah, Puff the Magic Dragon, Dungeon Dragons, and Toothless on How to Train a Dragon. So what does your skin taste like? Anger. To taste me is to relieve me. Every lick taken makes me sweeter, and where my heart lives is hard candy. When you look in the mirror, what do you see? A God fighting for the love of the people living in the world I created. What is your greatest worry for the next generation? That we're the last generation. Tell us about your birth. I was just simply the accident that won the race to the egg. What color are your angel wings? See, I'm closer to a saint than an angel. Saints are people love so much that in their death, they indemnify their sins and immortalize for good things. Describe your black role model. Flawed, confident, God-fearing, sexy, and spiritual. Kind of like the love child between Marvin Gaye, Prince, and Malcolm X. What is the one thing you wish people knew about you? That even when I'm smiling and successful, beyond my family and my people, the happiness seems rented because it can all be taken away from me when they choose. And by they, I mean white people that are in power. If you can say anything, you want it. And know that people all over the world would hear you and actually hear you, what would you say? That we belong together. How would you describe your history in 6 words? Here I am, the black Superman. Boom, there you go. Hey there, black child. Hey there, brown child. Hey there, young child swinging from the tree. Instead of losing chains, now you just shoot me. See you next time with bulletproof skin. They figure out a new way to kill us again. Hands up, don't shoot is what we say. I can't breathe, don't kill me that way. My spirit don't die. God loves me. Tell the pearls of the world a newborn baby. First, who deserves an epidemic, not a situation. If it's not an epidemic to you, that means it's not affecting you yet. I bet if a group killed comes from a group like you, it would be an epidemic to you. But hold up, stop, and fist this. Around the age when I was old enough to go outside and play by myself, my mother said, boy, when you get stopped by the police, if you get stopped by the police, because they do that sometimes, don't do anything that might get you killed or locked up. In fact, stay in this neighborhood, on this block, in front of this building so that you're close to home, baby. And that's exactly where these boys are murdered, in their neighborhoods, on their blocks, in front of their buildings, and close to home. This is poverty of a soul, living in a wealth of pain. How do you explain it? Ripping the life out of an unarmed body. And I don't know what to say, so I begin to act. Like, my name is Michael Erica Oscar. I live in Ferguson, Brooklyn, and Oakland, living like the black boys do, die like the black boys do. And they say, Tupac, please don't overreact because black boys are under attack. And that's mostly said about those who are not black.
And I feel like I'm under attack. See, it's hard. It's hard being human when you started out as property. It's hard being human when you're the anomaly. It's hard being human, you're minoritized. Understand it's hard being human? When you learn that once, you consider just 3/5 of one. So see us as heartbeats and not target sheets. And this ain't just about black boys or 200 kidnapped girls or condemning all the police in the world. This is about deconstructing systems of oppression. Break away from the chains, unshackling our brains and seeing all humans as humane. Turn down for what? This gives us every reason to simply turn up. Unless our eyelashes, let them flutter to the floor. Catch as much as I can in my eye so that the dirt never gets in yours. Come on now. Is sacrifice that hard or is it uncomfortable? Is privilege a right or is it comfortable? Ferguson, Missouri deconstructs the myth that we live in a post-racial consensus. We need to work together or remain separate forever. Not a moment, but a movement. How much death does it take before we see life? They've been murdering us since Jesus Christ. And the Lord said, black lives matter. Not just white bodies matter, everybody matters. But when young white bodies get snatched, everything you do to catch those body snatchers, but not kidnappers of black and brown bodies, it's true. Check 1776, 1812, and 1492. When white bodies leave from rooms, remember black and brown bodies fight suicide too. Recognize that darker bodies get abused too, just like white bodies do, but it seems to not matter what happened to a white body, but anybody that's hurt should have somebody alert, a body that consists in the matter. We all matter. When black and brown bodies get hurt, should have white bodies too, until those bodies are rescued. All I'm asking is if somebody remind everybody that everybody is a beautiful human body. Turn to the person next to you and say, you're beautiful. Turn to the person on the other side of you and say, you're beautiful. Turn to the person behind you and say, you're beautiful. And if you have someone in front of you, most of them say, you smell good and you're beautiful. Now, if you could stand, rise your feet for a moment. Rise your feet for a moment. If you could, rise your feet for a moment. Pull out your cell phone. Pull out your cell phone if you could. You're still all right? You're still all right? You're good? Yeah, you're still with you. Still together? Yes?
Yes?
So while you have your phones out, what I want you to do is on the count of three, I'm going to say love. And when I say love, what I want you to do is move from the space where you are right now and then find someone here that you didn't come here with this evening and ask them if you can be immortalized photogenically in time for a moment. That's just a poetic way of saying, can you take a selfie with me? You do not have to take a selfie. I'll ask you, do you have to take a selfie?
No.
You do not. And there's any number of reasons why you may not take a selfie. For example, if I ask, what's your name?
Melody.
If I ask Melody to take a selfie, say no.
No.
I should not think.
That's my
voice. Melody's just, she must hate me. But if I see Melody and, what's your name?
Ginger.
And Ginger taking a selfie like 3 seconds later, I shouldn't think, oh, they got smoke with me. That is a problem. That's not it. It's just the universe didn't have it that we would take a selfie. It's okay. Let me say it's okay.
Okay.
All right, but enjoy. But if you're going to be in it, be present as possible. Okay? Can we do that? Yes. And then after that's done, what I'll probably ask you to do is share the selfies that you want to share with myself. I'll give you the phone number, and then what I'll do is turn it into a collage, and then I'll share them with Lynn and Kathleen, and then they will put the immortalized genius and beauty that was here this evening somewhere online, I imagine. So you can share those. That probably will be the same number I'll give you to share the haikus and the groupies that you wrote. Okay? But I'll do that later on in the evening. But right now, what we're going to do is do this selfie thing, and then we'll get into the list. Sounds good? Yes?
Yes.
All right. Love. Good boy, there you go. Don't forget to take a selfie with the camera person.
Thank you.
Thank you. Friends and family, start off your feet. Now, welcome your host, Brother Open Mike. You know how that, the reason why all this happened, that was the best thing. It's like she planned all of it. That is perfect. More love, show more love.
Thank you so much, Jamil, for introducing me and, you know, always finding ways to bring everyone together. It was very powerful, and thank you for sharing your art with us. It was wonderful. Big round of applause for Jamil. All right, so the first person we have up today is Junko Ogawa, who will be performing a musical piece tonight. She'll be performing her original song, Hey My Friend, in which she believes that peace in the world starts from being nice to each other with people around us. So let's give it up for Junko.
I don't want to be alone.
so much, Junko. Next up, we have Cheryl Melody Baskin, who will be performing a written piece for us tonight. As someone who has experienced prejudice, bullying, and bias firsthand, my dream for peace is an original poem that expresses her vision of a world that embodies the vibration of loving consciousness, tolerance, compassion, empathy, peace, justice, celebration of diversity, and most of all, hope. It is published in her latest book, Peace Dreamer, A Journey of Hope in Bad Times and Good. Let's give it up for Cheryl.
Thank you. Please dream right along with me. Imagine a day will come when those who have the power to destroy the world suddenly feel a transformational shift in their hearts to save the world. Believe, a day will come when every heart on earth opens to the healing energy of love, kindness, compassion, empathy, diversity, celebration, and peace. Dream, a day will come when no one is ever judged again based on their color, race, religion, creed, nationality, gender, age, ability, social status, or sexual orientation. Trust. A day will come when we see each other through the warm eyes of love. Rejoice. A day will come when the Statue of Liberty stands tall once again and greets all humanity back to its shores with love. Envision, a day will come when the world chooses to cooperate, collaborate, and do what is best for the well-being of the collective whole. Care. A day will come when we realize how important it is to stop our busy lives and listen to each other's feelings, thoughts, and life experiences without judgment. We will simply listen from a place of love. Visualize. A day will come when conflicts are resolved through nonviolent solutions, empathic listening, common ground compromise, and the healing power of love. Celebrate. A day will come when a healing light shines through and around Mother Earth and the whole world makes a conscious decision to stand for love, unity, justice, equality, and peace. Because we're all one people. All one global nation, all one planet, together we can live. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Cheryl. Some very powerful words there. Next up, we have Ginger McRae, who will also be performing a spoken word or written piece. She will be performing a poem called God of the Brokenhearted, written by Omid Safi. Omid Safi is a gifted teacher and an award-winning author and the founder and main instructor of illuminated courses, one of which is a 10-day trip to Morocco where Ginger met Omid and learned about radical love through the heart of Rumi. This poem was written with love, justice, and peace in mind for those suffering in the Middle East. Let's give it up for Ginger.
I'd just like to preface this by saying I am an independent spirit advocating for peace, love, and justice. Although I personally do not practice any form of organized religion, I have friends who are quite devout, whom I love and hold dear. Here is a prayer Omid Safi wrote in response to the suffering out of Palestine and Israel. God of the brokenhearted, you always say that you close to, God of the brokenhearted, you always say that you are close to those whose hearts are broken. O God of love, God of mercy, God of justice, we are broken, brokenhearted. Be with us now. Noah called on you. I am overwhelmed. Help me. God of the brokenhearted, we are overwhelmed. Help us. Save us from this storm that would drown us all. God of love, God of mercy, have mercy on us, for the enemy has none. God of love, God of mercy, we are the least of these, the poor, the orphan, the widow, the refugee, in the eyes of much of the world, erased and unseen. We have no one but you. Raise your dead and bathe them in light. Have mercy on the ones buried under the rubbles where no earthly aid is coming. Protect your children, our youth, our hopes, our dreams, our women, our men, our elders, our land, our olive trees, our dignity, what is left of our humanity. Awaken the conscience of the world. Stop the oppressors. Humble the arrogant. Raise up the humbled. God of love, God of mercy, be with us now. For the night is dark and filled with terrors, and so are many of the days. God of love, God of mercy, you are the light. Be with us now. Lighten our burden. Ease our hearts. Fill us with light. Bring your peace. Enfold us in your peace. Wrap us in your peace. Within us, in our families, in our community, with the neighbor, with the stranger, with the stranger. So that the land may be worthy of being called a holy land. Amen. Amen. I have one more poem written by a young Palestinian man who also studied at Harvard University. His name is Mosab Abu Toha, and the poem is called A Voice from Beneath. I want to drown myself in the silence of absence, to fill my pockets with poems and throw myself in a lazy river. A distant voice calls upon me to build a room from straw and clay, to raise a black flag in the night, to play the piano to the crossing owl. A voice from beneath shakes my desk. The ink spills on my drowsy pants. It pummels my fingers and constricts my breath. It asks me to stop writing heavy poems. Poems that have bombs and corpses, destroyed houses and shrapnel-covered streets, lest the words stumble and slip into the bloody potholes. That voice takes away my voice. It squeezes my poetry pages, tears them from my head. Blood showers my curly hair. My desk becomes crimson red. Screams fill the cracks in the walls and the potholes in the nameless roads. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Ginger, for your piece. Next up, we have Mr. Tom Smith, who will be performing a musical piece for us. He'll be performing Plant the Seed, which is his original song comparing the challenges and rewards of gardening to those of parents and teachers in a world where kindness and justice cannot be assumed. Let's give it up for Mr. Tom Smith.
my garden, labor without end. Most of my time spent with insects and weeds. But when I count the cost against what would be lost, I plant the seed. I plant
very much, Tom, for that beautiful song. Really resonated with me. Next up, we have Liam Palacios, who'll be performing a written piece that Cheryl Perrault was actually going to read today, who couldn't make it, unfortunately. And this is actually authored by the man that she mentors in prison. Cheryl regrets not being able to be here to read this, but she does send her greetings and good spirit. And Liam actually used to film her Wake Up and Smell the Poetry events at HCAM when he was in high school, and also presented his own poems at a few of her poetry events that were held for students. And he's going to read Cheryl's selection for her right now. Let's give it up for Liam.
Shane has been incarcerated at Concord MCI since he was 19 years of age. He is now 45 years old. In January 2024, he graduated with his bachelor's degree in civic justice from Tufts University Prison Initiative of the Titch College of Civic Life. As a recent graduate, Shane is serving as a mentor to undergraduate students in the TUPIT program. He is also a poet and writer and has had his poetry published in the Resentencing Journal. Shane also has a compilation of his poetry, which is entitled A Poet Can't Blink. Cheryl Perrault has been on Shane's partaker mentoring team for the past 4 years. She believes that she has not only learned a great deal from Shane during his years of study in the TUPIT program, but also believes that Shane has mentored her about the transformative power of education in prison systems on the inside and outside. And furthermore, how important it is for all of society to care for incarcerated people as part of our community. So here's the poll. It was the armed cop standing over my father's left body that was the start of my family's troubles. It was the red stain soaking through the white sheet and the blue Nike sneaker sticking out from underneath my neighborhood that was my American flag. It was the invisible scarlet line that outlined and undermined our bodies and community that was my home foreclosed before I even existed. It was the condemned buildings I ran from while walking to school. It was 1,000 students in class and a teacher who couldn't remember my name. My home was an extension of the dirty cardboard box I pretended was a fortress. It was the scent of ackee and saltfish and fried dumplings and the vibration of reggae music staggering into my bedroom window on a Saturday morning summer breeze. It was every family on our street getting dressed on Easter Sunday when I couldn't even find my church shoes. It was always landlords with their hands out and Jehovah Witnesses with their hands out and pastors getting 10% of whatever we didn't have that kept us tithed to food stamps. It was the days when mommy was late for her second job and I had to be late for my first day of school. It was her cooking dinner for everybody, then me noticing she didn't even have a spoon. I was the last of my siblings to be born into my family, the one they called the wash belly because I rinsed out her womb. Before I could even blink, it was the twisted metal barbed wire spiraling through a concrete eternity that was my white picket fence around the American dream, that became sleepless nights reading and writing under low prison cell lights. But it was an inherited gratitude for knowledge, my upbringing, and love for family and community that made me sign up for college. It was the lingering sounds of words spoken by my Tufts professors and mentors that showed me a space where my history could be a better part of our future. That was the chance for my ink to form the many lines of my papers, spelling out what was once before impossible. I befriended the books and scripts and tomes and made sure that ink and paper would never be alone. A clean rag, mop bucket, and dirty broom, I swirled around prison classroom floors, desks, and whiteboards. I had been up before sunrise and the sun watched me read and write as it settled into the night sky. It was on the coldest winter nights, my mind in books, when I felt the heat of my ancestors who died without learning to read or write. I am the son of a strong woman who taught me there's no such thing as probably, you do it or you don't. I am the son of relentless efforts of abolitionists who trusted in humanity that pushed open the heavy doors of ignorance, pointing me towards new opportunities. I had to become my own poetry, and through all I have read and learned, my rhyme scheme was hard to change. It was ACAB in poverty when our food lines became stanzas from the unreasonable demands being made of us. It was archaic laws that had to be changed and the releasing of chains that have been jingling since slavery. It is this change that gave us back our youth in the form of redemption. It is the idea that civic engagement includes everyone, from skyscrapers to pavement without excuses or exemptions. Everything I ever experienced has shaped my life in some way. And everything I can remember has shaped the person I am still discovering today.
All right, thank you so much, Liam. Up next is Kathleen Dinsmore, who will also be performing a written piece for us tonight. She'll be reading a poem authored by another man who is mentored by the Hawkington Freedom Team member, Judith Wine Taylor. All right, let's give it up for Kathleen.
This is from Rinaldo, and it's sent from Concord MCI to Judy Weinthaler. Here's some background information. Rinaldo was sentenced at age 20 for up to 25 years. In January 2024, he graduated with his BA from the Tufts Prison Education Program. He has also completed several certification programs at Concord, woodworking, health services, public speaking, and mentoring other students. He has been a leader in telling his story to high school students who visit the prison. For his good behavior and achievements, he will be eligible for parole within the next 2 years. He recently wrote in a letter of appreciation to the mentoring program, quote, "The way education transformed my life was an eye-opener. School helped me understand the significance of a community. It taught me what can be morally just, and the way a view of morality may depend on your perspective. It taught me ethics, different types of love, and the benefits of camaraderie. It is people like you that help individuals like me to understand that there is such a thing called second chances, and a kind of love that propels us to become the best versions of ourselves." So here's his piece called Inside Social Justice. Social justice from the inside is something that starts within. It begins with self-healing, identifying triggers, and deep digging. I grew up with food insecurities, and because of this, I turned to burglary. Breaking and entering was the pipeline to my endeavors. The efforts to accomplish doing the right thing felt like a tremor. The harmony of poetry and music is what kept me free. Free from self-destruction because of lies that were said to me. Like, you're dumb, you're small, and your voice doesn't matter. But they all sounded like polarities that I needed to shatter. My problems started at home with verbal assault, leading me to think I was never a part of a family that was more broken than I was. How silly of me to think this is tough love. Love was left alone no matter how tough things got. Until April 18, 2009, when I had my last shot. Convicted at 20, I vowed to change my life. 15 years later, 2 college degrees and a wife. The journey wasn't easy, every step was a plight. Shout out to all my mentors and everybody that share my light. Civic engagement was at the forefront, therefore making social justice and love winners of this fight. Thank you for all of your messages that you've written to Shane and Reynaldo, and all of the wonderful words that we've already heard. So I would like to begin the second half with Kelly Jenkins. Kelly is a transgender woman who moved from East Tennessee to Massachusetts in 2014 in hopes of creating a better life for herself in which she could fully be her authentic self. She succeeded, and she wrote a piece that focuses on hope, which she will share today. So please welcome Kelly.
Dang it, y'all. I'm so glad to be here. I needed this today. I'm a middle school teacher, and this week was a little bit of a challenge with my students. So thank you all for showing me that what we're doing here will trickle down to my middle schoolers. Nearly a decade ago, I took a leap of faith, and without knowing anyone or anything about New England, packed my 4-door Honda Civic with everything I could fit into it, including my 2 dogs and cat, and made the move from East Tennessee to Central Massachusetts. I've been a middle school teacher of some sort or another since 2003 and worked with every kind of kid imaginable. Urban students, rural students, students that struggled in school, and students that excelled in school. But I had never worked with transgender middle schoolers that I was aware of. As a transgender woman myself, I wanted to be a part of that community. I went on Google and typed in camps for transgender youth. Camp Aeronautic in New Hampshire popped up, and I immediately signed up to help. I'm here to tell you that after spending 1 week with these amazing children, my life was forever changed. Maybe this is what social justice looks like. In them, I saw hope. Hope for the future, hope for myself, and hope for society. 1 month later, fueled by hope, I was living in Massachusetts, and my life has forever changed. And here is the crazy part. It is because of the kindness of another volunteer from that camp I found a place to live. Having only known me for 1 week, they offered their home to me and my pets so I could get out of Tennessee. Maybe this is what social justice looks like. Helping people and wanting nothing in return. Now I work in a Massachusetts public school, Worcester Public Schools, within a program that helps students who are struggling to make it in their local school. They are in survival mode when they arrive in my classroom. I know survival mode. I live survival mode. It helped me to connect with my students in ways I never thought possible. I am fortunate to have been able to turn my trauma as a trans teacher from East Tennessee in a positive way to help others. Maybe this is what social justice looks like. I told my students I was going to share my thoughts on social justice tonight. One of them came up to me, little cute kid, sixth grader, and asked if he could help with my presentation. I let him know I would be happy to accept his help. He wrote two poems for us, which is amazing in itself. We had major struggles with this student when we started the poetry section of our lessons. He didn't like poetry in any form. He was very clear about this, screaming, throwing himself on the floor, stomping out of the room. Poetry is done, there's no such thing as good poetry, and he left the room. Things change in this world. Maybe this is what social justice looks like. So I present to you two poems from my sixth grade student who has his own vision of social justice. When I hear social justice, I feel it means that everybody should be equal. I notice that some people are not accepted by a lot of people just because of their race or identity. I know this shouldn't be happening, and I feel I must make a change in this world. This world has a lot of things that shouldn't be here, such as hatred based on looks or gender. I must make a change in this world to make it better. Although we must be forgiven forgetters, I don't know why this hatred has ever been here. But I still must erase it as if it is a mistake on math. There is no fear. That's the first thing. I appreciate you having us do a haiku because he chose to write a haiku for you all as well. The second poem is a haiku. Now I will give this social justice for you all. No one will steal it. Maybe this is what social justice looks like. Thank you.
Thank you.
Presenter is Namrata Mathur. Namrata will be performing a piece called Daughters of Tomorrow, which discusses the limitless potential of a girl child. Please welcome Namrata.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I want to start by thanking each and every one of you for your art, your creativity, and the quality that has been brought into this room tonight. There's a lot of peace that comes with being in spaces where you are not judged. You don't realize it and you don't feel it until you're not judged. So this is a space where people are equal and the feeling is very warm and healing. So just want to thank everyone for that. A quick second about this poem. So I am a very proud Hopkinton resident, a Hopkinton mother, a part of the South Asian Circle of Hopkinton. I sit on their board with Smitha, who is here with us tonight as well. And that group of people has sort of brought out the best in me. So as a poet, I've been writing poetry for a long, long time. That was triggered by a very tragic episode in my own life. But there's been so many places to put that poetry into. So this poem called Daughters of Tomorrow was written to highlight the girl child across the world. Especially in the Eastern cultures, sometimes we're not given as much importance as the sons, and this is a place to create equalism for the girl child. So here it goes. I am a woman I am. I am the source for the existence of man. At the center of my being is the core of all existence. So help me, liberate me, don't be the resistance. If I thrive, we will rise and energize the momentum for all mankind. Propel me with courage, be the wings to my ability. Add my intelligence into your reality. Don't close me out to show your clout. Let's celebrate our maturity for humble equality. If I win, we win. Us together will nourish our courage. Together, we will reach for so much more. We will aim higher, think faster, fight stronger, love longer, accelerate, elevate, motivate, multiply what we can achieve. We pave a path for a winning start, our agency then ours to own. Not anything we beg or borrow, limitless shall be the daughters of tomorrow.
Very much, Namita. Our next guest is going to be Kathy Weaver Taylor. Kathy will be performing We Are Mud People, which is a song that began in 2016 and was completed in 2023 while wandering around at Chaco Canyon, New Mexico. Ancient people kept track of the moon and stars and lived sustainably, just like we need to do today. We welcome you.
I think I can skip the mic. So Chaco Canyon is northwestern New Mexico, and it's really remote. And then you get there, and it's like you're on the moon. And you're like, where am I? So the first morning, I spent a morning with a ranger showing me all the petroglyphs. And there's specific places, and there are all these, little figures and things. And I took a long walk, and on the way back, it had rained the night before, and in the mud was this little stick figure. And I heard this voice that said, we were just mud people. And that whole week I was there, I kept getting these little snatches of this song, and I kept singing, would repeat it and things. And I had to finish it, and then I have to sing it. And I have to tell you, I'm known as an artist and an occasional poet, but I don't sing. But I'm going to sing for you tonight. We are the mud people, and we pray for rain. We are the mud people, and we sing about the rain. We are the mud people, it's all about the rain. Slick, soft, slippery, oozing mud. We make our pots for the water to go in, and little pots to store all our seeds. We place them in the mud, we grow whatever we need. Corn grows tall, beans swirl around, squash plants cover all over the ground. These three sisters keep us true, bountiful harvest when we're through. We are the mud people, and we pray for rain. We are the mud people, and we sing about rain. We are the mud people, it's all about the rain. Slick, soft, slippery, oozing mud. We smoothed off floors and then all the walls. Baked by the sun and dried by the wind. Every night we dream within. We are the mud people, we pray for rain. We are the mud people, we sing about the rain. We are the mud people, it's all about the rain. Slick, soft, slippery, oozing mud. Between all the bricks, we make them all stick. Kiva's, Eve is round to hear the sound of dancing feet upon the ground, placed by the moon and traced by the sun, ceremony everyone. We are the mud people and we pray for rain. We are the mud people, we sing about rain. We are the mud people, it's all about the rain. Slick, soft, slippery, oozing mud. They say we too are made of the stuff. Creator blew in piece of the sky. We gotta return it when we die. And die we do, and die we must. What's left behind just turns to dust. Yes, we are mud people. We pray for rain. We are the mud people. We sing about rain. We are the mud people, it's all about the rain. In this, you and I, we are really just the same. We are all mud people, we all need the rain. Just the right amount of rain, really just the same, because we're all mud people.
Our next guest is going to be Anna Gamel. Drawing from the deep roots of familial bonds, Anna's poem, The Fig Tree, grows from witnessing the tender relationship between her father and son, reflecting a lifetime of love that was nurtured under the Greek sun. Even though her journey took her to America, her family always returned to Greece every summer. She has been a resident of Hopkinton for 30 years and a business owner of Body and Beyond Massage Therapy and Wellness. Please welcome Anna.
Hi.
Hello.
So, in Greece, the figs are the most sacred trees that we have, and in the island that I come from, there's a tree that is at least 1500 years old. It's an amazing tree. So this poem is written for my dad and my son. The fig tree. In the heart of the summer's embrace, on the island of Greece, where the waves whisper secret to the sandy shore, and the breeze is kissing your cheeks, a fig tree stood, ancient and wise, a majestic piece. The sacred land holds its roots, the branches heavy with lore. The fruit, enticing, lures with splendid aroma, a bite unleashes sweetness, wisdom floating through old stories savored in the taste of the ancient new. Each year, a journey stitched in the fabric of time. A little boy with eyes wide will sail the sea to where his grandfather waited in youthful prime. Beneath the ancient fig tree where they were meant to be. Together, they venture hand in hand to the ancient fig tree. The grandfather, spry, will climb the youthful glee with youthful glee. From the high above the tree, the figs will fall like a sweet rain. The boy, below catching joy, amidst the game. Every year, a question asked with hope so bright, can I climb today? Is it finally my time? Under the golden light? Not yet, my child. Your time has not come to bear. Patience, you will be there. His grandfather said, tending to his care. Then, the year arrives when the boy reaches 10. They're filled with the future, now and then. Today, today, said the old man, with smile, wisdom, and twinkle in his eyes. It's your turn to climb, to touch the sky a while. With pounding heart, the boy ascended, brave and bold. The end came, a beaten crew. But he stood firm, as his grandfather knew. From high with the fig trees embrace, he saw the world from a newfound place. His grandfather's trust, like a beacon bright, guiding him through the dance of light. The pain of the ends, a fleeting sting, has no match for the pride he will bring. For up in the tree, with a sky so vast, the boy found his courage deep in the vast. Under the fig tree, with leaves whispering soft, grandfather and grandson aloft. A bound deepened with each fig caught. In the shade of branches, life's lessons taught. Though each year woven into the next, with love and tradition, no need for text. In Greece, by the tree where memories cling, together they celebrate the gift life will bring.
Symbolism and greater meaning of until much later. This song was written during the civil rights era and the struggle of persons of color in America, which is still relevant and powerful today. Thank you, Laura.
Thank you. I was going to move the mics, but everyone's so quiet that I don't think I need to, so I'm just going to sit here, I think. I was hoping, I wish I had an original piece to play, but I didn't have anything that really fit, but so inspired by everyone tonight that maybe next time I will hope so. But feel free to sing along. Everybody, I feel like a lot of people know this song, so this is Blackbird.
Blackbirds sing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You're only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbirds sing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. To be free, blackbird fly.
By the late Iowata and will be read by her surviving husband, Norman Schneider. Iowata was a community healer who passed away in November 2016. Iowata and Norm operated a wellness center in Medway, Massachusetts, and were heavily involved in community arts and healing locally in the Metro West area and across the country when they would take their RV on the road cross country to help people in need. Norman will follow the reading with some Native American flute music, which he performs at traditional local ceremony events. Norman, we welcome you.
Don't have quite enough hands to hold everything. My wife and I got involved with the Native American community probably 30 years ago, and I'm still involved with it, and there's a powwow coming up at the La Salette Shrine the second weekend of June, and there's some posters over on the table over there. My wife was a person of peace and justice, and she had one of the things that she had was a thing called Voice of Freedom, Earth Spirit. And she did one-woman shows, plays, poetic dramas, multicultural music, dance, and storytelling. And it wasn't all in one week. It was over a period of, probably 15 years. We did a lot of things. And the poem I'm going to read has to do with Idle No More, and I don't know if people know too much about that. It was an ongoing protest movement founded in 2012 by four Native women and one non-Native ally, in a grassroots movement among the Aboriginal people of Canada, comprising of First Nation, Métis, Inuit people, and other Aboriginal, non-Aboriginal supporters in Canada, and to a less extent internationally. The popular movement was included round dances that they used to put on at some of the big shopping malls and things of that sort, and they had blockades for rail lines. So the poem is about Idle No More, and the name of it is With the Sun We Rise by Iowata Schneider. Idle No More, with the sun we rise. Earth stewards, with eagle's eyes, guide all life. Earth beings, full of life, rise with us. Rising up, today is new, another world coming. Listen, you will hear our new world, feel our life. We will round dance, all ancestors joining us. Birds singing. We will round dance all over the planet, healing life. Dance unites everyone, loving the Earth Mother, rising for her future. Hear the drum, Earth's heartbeat calling us. Excuse me. Imagine generations of peace, sustainable life. No, there was a song that I heard on WUMB, which is the University of Mass station, and the words really got to me. It, one earth, many colors, one humankind. And if we could just do that in the world, it would be an awesome world to live in. Thank you.
Thank all of you for coming. You really, each one of you made this evening very special for all of us. And I'd like to invite you to future events coming up in May and June. That is part of the Artful Connections series with the Hopkinton Freedom Team and the Hopkinton Center for the Arts. There are pamphlets in the table. On May 18th, we're going to be having a Frederick Douglass reading on the common with music and conversation and other surprises. And then on June 8th, there is the fourth annual Pride Parade and event celebration afterwards, also here at the Hopkinton Center for the Arts. So I hope that you'll be around and think to join us and stay tuned for more events in the fall. We really are excited about this new collaboration with the HCA, and if you would like to be on our mailing list, there is a QR code on the Hopkinton Freedom Team pamphlet in the back. You can sign up there. So, I'm sad to end this meeting, but happy to, again, to have Jamil one more time. So, thank you so much, Jamil. Thank you so much. Awesome.
So, I just want to plug your book, because you mentioned it when you came and did your reading, but I didn't really catch the title, and it just kind of hit me, Peace Dreamer, A Journey of Hope and Bats Out the Anger. That's something we go all day. I think you said something like that, but for some reason reading it seems to just kind of hit me a little different. So, I don't know, I mean, you're there, stuff like that, but check that out, check out the book, all right? Three pieces of business. This is the three things before we kind of, I had a whole other thing in mind, but just the evening has, you know, you leave room for energy to just kind of be shared, and that's what happened. So, here's two things that I need you to do real quick. Pull your phones out, I'm not taking pictures and nothing like that. So, because I remember my parents was like, do we have to do anything else with the phones? I was like, no, one more thing. So, remember, you took the photos before, we need to get those. So I'm going to give you the phone number to send, it's really two first, so these, this one is two things at one time. So send the appropriate best selfies that you have to, and also the haikus and or the group pieces. And somehow separate the three of them. If you're the lucky owner of all three of those, separate them somehow so we get them. And like I said, what I'll do is create a file and I'll share them with Lynn and with Kathleen. And another thing I want to share with people before we even do that piece is that the ACA's great art transcends any sort of rhetoric and reaches us in a different ways. Can we show some love for art? Can we show love for art? And the Hopkinton Freedom Team is an incredible, incredible engine of love, an incredible engine of movement, an incredible engine of inclusion and trust. And so, and they was the first team to create its own nonprofit energy. And just move, they also are an incredible example of community and education and family being together and working together. I want folks also to know the last poem, the poem that I did that had something about the police and stuff like that. Sometimes folks miss the whole energy of it, but I want to share that absolutely I rock with the police and with the leader, we can work together and be in community together. So I just want to make sure that's clear that folks know that. Can we show love for the Hopkinton Freedom Team? If you play an instrument, Zeeva, can you come up? This is with your instrument. Yes. Come up with your instrument. So, in my mind, this is how this would work. Come on, you're too far. We're together.
Okay.
We're together, family. And I have to, just on a personal note, my friend and I, we do a lot of things together. And I can't imagine being in your shoes and how you keeping your queen and your life and your energy. So I want to share love with you for that. And I just want to acknowledge that you're keeping that journey alive. And I've never met her, but I meet her through you. So I appreciate you for that. Yeah. Can we show some love? Thank you. I'm going to do one poem, and then we'll end with that. Kind of think it's already 9, and then HCA probably want to kick us out, but or not, I don't know. But in my head, how it starts is you would just play something, whatever comes to mind. You play what you know already? Or
I don't play anything.
Just play.
Play whatever comes to mind.
Yeah, whatever. That's it. Let that play. And then you would join in, and then you would join in. You're going to join in last, whatever, however you add on to it. Then I'll just add the poem into it. The name of the poem is called Believe. So that's what it's about. We were supposed to have 3 guitars, but someone left. Yeah, go for it, Norman. Yeah, and then you just play with, just keep playing the whole time. Just hear it out and enjoy.
I think this is an F sharp.
We're getting technical. Okay.
Yeah, that's the problem with it. These things were called a loft. And when a brave saw this pretty lady, he'd go out and he'd make a flute. And he'd use his hands for the measurements. So each flute was made and it wouldn't sound anything
I
like it. Now we've gotten to the point where everything has to have labels on it.
Alright. Yeah, he's rocking on. Hate believes that it can break you. But love believes in you more than hate, and hate is in his own family. We need you to believe in you more than not you can. Like that time, you ran away from yourself. Angels took flight, came back, and you found yourself. You didn't think that was possible. Believe that's possible. Believe it. And remember pain? And how we don't think that it's going to go away? And it's not until we begin to believe that it can go away that it starts to go away. So why not believe that we can be together? Believe that we can harmony. Believe in pain with people sharing. Believe in forgiveness, not forgiveness. Believe in healing. Believe in love. Believe in your love. How can we not? We are here. We're alive. We're alive. Believe possible. We acknowledge tonight that everything is impossible until we do it. We bear so many impossibilities tonight that only possibilities that have come to life. We made it possible. And if you're like me, you may have been part of the conversation, but doctors told our creators, your child's not going to make it. And they challenged death with life, believing life and love win.
cry, pray, move slow, value bed rest, to give us the best shot against all odds at life. And here you are. Here we are. Thank you for making tonight, Molly.